This is Howard Langer in New York. I'm speaking to you from the top floor of a 42nd Street skyscraper, headquarters of the Fund for the Republic. Directly across the table sits Dr. Robert M. Hutchins, president of the fund. He is tall, graying at the temples, wears a conservative business suit. Dr. Hutchins' background is one of staunch Yankee independence. He is descended from a long line of doctors, ministers, and sea captains. Robert Maynard Hutchins was born in Brooklyn, New York, January 17, 1899. During World War I, he served in the U.S. Ambulance Corps overseas. He studied law at Yale, became a professor there, and rose to become dean of the law school at the age of 29. At 30, he was president of the University of Chicago. He revised the university curriculum along European lines. Bright high school students were allowed to enter and graduate college early. Some got out at 18. Hutchins instituted the Great Books Program, which encouraged adults to read and discuss great classics. He abolished university football. He placed the institution's facilities at the disposal of the Manhattan Project to develop the first atomic bomb. Atomic energy was born at Chicago's Stagg Field, where the first controlled chain reaction took place in 1942. In 1947, Hutchins headed a 13-man commission to report on the American press. We'll hear more about that later. In 1951, Dr. Hutchins resigned as chancellor of the University of Chicago to become associate director of the Ford Foundation. 3 years later, he became president of the Fund for the Republic. Dr. Hutchins, tell us something about the Fund for the Republic. When and why was it organized?
The Fund for the Republic is a foundation organized by the Ford Foundation in 1952 for the purpose of defending and advancing the principles of the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, and the Bill of Rights.
Whose idea was it to set it up?
Well, I was implicated in some way in starting it as an officer of the Ford Foundation. But all the officers of the Ford Foundation participated, and the trustees of the Ford Foundation approved.
In just a few short years, Dr. Hutchins, the fund has been both praised and attacked in many quarters. The New York Times has declared, quote, "The fund has helped strengthen American democracy," unquote. But Fulton Lewis Jr. has said that the fund is a dangerous organization. Now, some congressmen have denounced the fund, and others have saluted it. Why is it that people have such violently different views about it?
Because people have violently different views about the subjects with which the fund deals. The fund deals with civil liberties, freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of the press. These are the most controversial subjects there are.
Well, what kinds of studies has the fund made?
The fund has been engaged in two or three different kinds of things. It has promoted the discussion of race relations in the South, where its object has been simply to keep the discussion going among reasonable or moderately reasonable or reasonably moderate people.
Yes.
About a third of the fund's expenditures have gone into this field. The fund has assisted writers and scholars who were interested in the field of civil liberties. And many studies have been published as a result of grants to individuals or to educational institutions for the work of individuals. The fund has been a reporting agency in the sense in which it has tried to bring before the people what is actually going on today in the field of civil liberties. For example, it conducted a study of blacklisting in the entertainment industry. It has conducted a study of fear in education. Are teachers frightened or aren't they? If so, what are they frightened of? It has a big report coming out soon on race and housing, because segregation in housing is a burning issue in many, almost all, metropolitan communities in this country. There's a big report coming out on the rights and liberties of the American Indian. So it goes over the field.